Hello and welcome today, and my apologies for a slightly delayed start. We had some technical issues, but here we go. My name is Angela Beaumont. I'm the Director of Operations at the Jefferson, and I'm welcoming Dr. Andrew Roth to a digital program on Valentine's Day, A Short History. Of the many holidays we celebrate in America, Valentine's Day is one of the most welcomed and rivals Christmas in terms of commercial activities and sales numbers. What is, if I may ask in a nonchalant way, the craze about this holiday? Is it that after many weeks of dull winter, we want to show appreciation to those who endured with us or escaped isolation and find new love and luck? Is it really a Hallmark invention, or does Valentine's Day have pre-industrial and pre-Christian roots? Answering those questions and more is what we'll work today to unpack in this installment of the Jefferson Education Society Digital Programming with Jefferson Scholar in Residence, Dr. Andrew Roth. Hello and welcome.
Good afternoon, Angela, and happy Valentine's Day.
Thank you. Happy Valentine's to you as well. Dr. Roth, you may recognize him from his book notes series he publishes at the Jefferson regularly weekly, or maybe his American Tapestry project that is being featured locally in Erie and on WQLN Public and nationally on the NPR One app and also as Jefferson Digital Programs. I'd like to note here his accomplished career in academic, from lecturing to leading as he taught various courses before going on to serve in administrations in Erie and lead Notre Dame College in Cleveland as its president before retiring and being named president emeritus. And breaking free from the tightening grip of retirement, Dr. Roth heeded the call to serve as the interim president at St. Bonaventure University. And that Jefferson wrangled him in too. He's been serving as a scholar in residence, offering numerous lectures, producing plenty of publications, and facilitating the Rainey Fellowship Program. Thank you, Dr. Roth. Since this program is first airing live on the Jefferson Facebook page, we'll work our way through as many questions from you, the viewers, as we can as we host this event. If you have a question, just leave it in below in the commentary section. And for more information about upcoming Jefferson events, please visit our website, jeseu.org, and like us on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. It is my pleasure to welcome you, Dr. Roth, back to the Jefferson Digital Stage. Thank you for joining us here.
I'm glad to be with you, Angela. Okay, let me share the screen here so that we can get sorted out and organized. And I want to make sure that we're sharing audio. We are. Let's start the program from the beginning. Yes. So crazy right now. Most incredibly. It's your girl. Me. It's your boy. So what we're listening to there, Beyonce, Valentine's Day. We're going to do a very short history of Valentine's Day. As Angela alluded to, this is an offshoot of the larger series, my American holiday series, in which we're looking at all of the holidays in America as we try to discover those things Americans hold in common, as we try to figure out ways to bridge the partisanship and cross the divide that is dividing American culture. One of the things we thought would be interesting is to look at American holidays, which of course are the things Americans love in common. Today, we're going to take a look at one holiday in particular, Valentine's Day, and in the next 45 minutes or so, give a very short history of this very ancient holiday, which still, as Angela suggested, is one of the three or four most widely celebrated holidays in the United States. In fact, Valentine's Day is the most widely celebrated holiday in the world. Although it is not an official holiday in any country, it is celebrated in just about every country in the world. But first, let's take a look at how it connects to the American holiday series. One tends to think of February maybe as the
one of the darker months, particularly for those of us who live in the north, one of the darker months. But February is actually has as many, if not more, holidays than any other month. It has, as you can see on this screen, 5 major holidays occur, or relatively speaking, major holidays occur in February. They range from the religious Candlemas on February 2nd, which of course is in the Christian tradition, the purification of Mary. The name Candlemas comes from the fact that people used to, I'm not so sure it's done as widely anymore as it was once done, would bring their candles to the church to be blessed. Of course, the more famous holiday associated with February 2nd is the common holiday called Groundhog Day, in which it might surprise people to know there are more than, there are many groundhogs around the country. It's not just Punxsutawney Phil in Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania, although that is the oldest. It was brought to America sometime in the 18th century by the earliest German immigrants. And then as in 1886 became a holiday, and as we know today, and if Phil sees his shadow, we have 6 more weeks of winter, which I believe this past February 2nd, he did see his shadow, and we'll have 6 more weeks of winter. But maybe you should take hope in the fact that Phil doesn't have a very good record. He's only right about 40% of the time, apparently. And of course, yesterday we had what is evolving into America's major secular holiday, the Super Bowl, which in top 10 spending, we'll see in a minute, comes in at number 7 or 8. We have President's Day, which once upon a time, we had 2 separate holidays in February, February 12th, President Lincoln's birthday, and February 22nd, George Washington's birthday. But the Uniform Holiday Act of 1968 turned that into President's Day in order to get a 3-day weekend. And actually, President's Day is a holiday that annoys me a wee bit, because we no longer honor Lincoln and Washington, and in effect don't really honor any presidents, although apparently we sell a lot of major appliances on that day. But regardless of President's Day sales, the biggest holiday in February by an overwhelming margin, the biggest holiday in February, the Super Bowl notwithstanding, remains Valentine's Day. So let's talk about how we got to now, how this happened, how Valentine's Day became not only the biggest holiday in February, but as we're going to discover, at least in terms of consumer spending, the third most widely celebrated holiday in American culture. So as we look at that, let's take a look at some notes from now, Valentine's Day. What goes on Valentine's Day? What's going to happen today and the days leading up to today? Well, as I said, Valentine's Day in terms of consumer spending ranks number 3. Christmas and Thanksgiving in the American tradition, and I think this is probably true throughout Europe, North America, and North America, Christmas and Christmas actually, Thanksgiving is a purely American holiday, but Christmas swamps everything. And the combined Christmas and Thanksgiving holidays, you can see the average spending will round that up. The average American spends $1,000 on Christmas and Thanksgiving. And you multiply that by 330 million, you're going to get a pretty big number. But number 2 is Mother's Day, and closer than you might think, at number 3, a mere $8 behind, is Valentine's Day. And so Valentine's Day, which we're going to learn in a moment, used to be the major holiday in America. The major consumer holiday was the first consumer holiday, we'll discover, still ranks at number 3. Significantly ahead of Easter and Father's Day, and then much further ahead of Halloween, which is becoming a bigger holiday. We discovered that when we looked at it last October. And I mentioned earlier, the Super Bowl has climbed into number 7. And I suspect that $88 of Super Bowl spending is primarily on food and snacks while people watch it on television. But regardless, Valentine's Day is the third most, if we use consumer spending as a measure, the third biggest holiday in American culture. And in terms of that, Americans will spend about $20 billion today, or in the couple of days leading up to it, on a variety of things. They will send 36 million heart-shaped boxes of chocolate. The average man spends about $130, the average woman about $70 on Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day is the second largest card-sharing holiday, The largest card-sharing holiday, of course, is Christmas. But around the world, 1 billion Valentine's cards will be sent. And in the United States, the number is about 160 million Valentine's cards of various types will be sent. Teachers, interestingly enough, get the most, followed by children, followed by moms, followed by wives, followed by girlfriends. And somewhere around $3.3 billion will be spent on flowers. And in an interesting little side note, according to the American Florist Association, about 18% of women send themselves flowers. Now, I'm not so sure 18% of women send themselves flowers, maybe 18% of all flower sales. Flower sales are purchased by women, but that, I found that to be an interesting statistic. Well, how did we get to now? How did we get to this 36 million boxes of chocolate? Those $20 billion spent on gifts and this landslide, this tsunami of cards and flower purchases. How did we get to this? What's Valentine's Day's origins? Well, that music in the background was the orgy music from the 60s Broadway hit, A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum, which is not where Valentine's Day began. But Valentine's Day actually has roots that go all the way back to an ancient Roman fertility festival. According to the Venerable Bede, and I think you can see my cursor on the screen, that is a drawing of him on, as you're facing your computer screen or video screen, however you're monitoring this, on the left, that is a drawing of the Venerable Bede, who was a 7th or 8th century Benedictine monk in England, sometimes known as the father of English history. And he is the source of the idea that Valentine's Day was created by Pope Gelasius I. This is a painting of him. No one actually knows what he really looked like, but a recreation of what he was assumed to look like. Pope Gelasius I's attempt to suppress a revival of the Lupercalia. The Lupercalia was an ancient Roman fertility festival. It was held on the Palatine Hill. The ceremony was conducted in the legendary cave on the Palatine Hill, in which the she-wolf suckled Romulus and Remus, the founders of Rome. The priests were called Luperci, sometimes called Februators. And what happened was they would sacrifice sheep and dogs, interestingly enough, then flay them and take the skin, and the skin would be attached to a wooden handle and turned into a thong-like, not a whip, they call it a whip's a little bit of a misnomer. And the priests, the Luperci, would come out and they would make a journey around the Palatine Hill, and they would touch women with that, you can see it here in the lower right-hand corner, with that Februus, it was called, whip. It's not a whip exactly, but that'll have to do for a word. And the notion was that they purified the women by doing that. And a woman touched by a Luperci during the celebration of the Lupercalia would become fertile, and at some time in that year would conceive and have a baby. Also, it was a fertility ritual in which they purified the fields in order to ensure a harvest. And it's ancient. It might sound exotic to 21st century ears, it was an established part of ancient Roman culture. Plutarch has it in his Life of Caesar that it was during the Lupercalia that Caesar refused the crown of Rome. Shakespeare has it in his Julius Caesar, in which Caesar asked Calphurnia, his wife, to be sure to stand out on the avenue so that Antony, who was a Luperci at the time, comes by and would touch her because, according to legend, it would heal their barrenness. Well, as most people, I think, know, most Jeffersonians, I think, know, when the Emperor Constantine converted the Roman Empire to Christianity in the 4th century, he was succeeded by Julian the Apostate and others who wanted to bring back the ancient ways. And so by the time you get into the 5th century, the 400s, Christianity's hold on Rome was somewhat tenuous. And in the late 5th century, there were plagues and a famine, and there was a revival of the Lupercalia. And in order to suppress that revival of the Lupercalia, it is alleged that Pope Gelasius I instituted and created the Feast of St. Valentine, Rome of Valentine, and that's, he did that on February 14th. The Lupercalia was celebrated on the Ides of February, February 15th. By the way, February, the very word itself means to purify, to make clean, which is why the Lupercalia were called Februators, and it's why this thong was called the Februus. In fact, it is that ancient tradition that gives the month its very name. It comes from the Latin mensis februarius, and it's the month of purification. In any event, Gelasius, in order to suppress, according to the Venerable Bede, this revival of the Lupercalia, declared February 14th the feast day of St. Valentine of Rome, which is interesting because there were two St. Valentines. In fact, there actually were three. There was one in North Africa who's not really relevant to this story, and created St. Valentine's Day in order to suppress the Lupercalia and to honor these two martyrs. St. Valentine of Rome was martyred in 269 by the Emperor Claudius for refusing to convert to paganism. As I have the notes here, he converted his jailer Asturias by healing his blind daughter Julia, and allegedly on the eve of his execution wrote the first Valentine to Julia, signing it "Your Valentine." Valentine of Rome is buried on the Via Flaminia on February 14th, or was buried on the Via Flaminia on February 14th, and that becomes a legendary spot. There was also another, St. Valentine of Terni. He was martyred in 273 AD by the Emperor Claudius for marrying Roman soldiers who were forbidden to marry. According to legend, to remind the men of their vows and God's love, he cut hearts from parchment. He wore an amethyst ring engraved with an image of Cupid. Amethyst became the birthstone for February and a symbol of love. And St. Valentine of Terni was also buried on the Via Flaminia, but not in the same spot as Valentine of Rome. Now, what's interesting is no one knows if there were actually two different people. It's possible that St. Valentine of Rome, who was in fact also the Bishop of Terni for a while, and St. Valentine of Terni might in fact be the same two people. Because of that, in 1969, the Roman Catholic Church removed them from the calendar of saints and no longer celebrates St. Valentine's Day as a religious feast day. Regardless of that, Valentine's Day has, however, continued to be celebrated. The Via Flaminia is an important for another reason, and it connects to Valentine's Day indirectly, but it also ties into the romantic and erotic overtones of Valentine's Day. Because on the Via Flaminia, on March 15th, the Ides of March, which in the old Roman calendar was in fact the vernal equinox, there was a celebration held on the Via Flaminia every year in which women and men came in pairs or paired off. They feasted in huts made of boughs under the open sky. A great deal of singing and drinking took place. And Ovid quotes Martial, "The grove of Anna Karenina delights in virgin blood." Now, Anna Karenina, who that is a recreation of the festival's icon, was not a real person. It comes from the Latin for Anna, year, annual, and Perenna for the Latin for perennial, and it just refers to the annual return of the beginning of the new year, because in the Roman calendar, March 1st used to be, before the Julian calendar corrected it, March 1st was actually New Year's. And again, Shakespeare has this in Ophelia's song, Ophelia's Valentine's song in Hamlet, when Ophelia says, "Tomorrow is St. Valentine's Day, all in the morning betime, and I am made at your window to be your Valentine. Then up he rose and donned his clothes and ducked the chamber door, let in the maid that out of maid never departed more." So just to bring that all to a conclusion, Valentine's Day's earliest roots, allegedly, according to the Venerable Bede, the great historian of the 8th century and the inventor of English history, the creator and founder of English history, Valentine's Day was founded by Pope Gelasius to suppress the revival of an ancient Roman fertility ritual. And for 1,000 years, Valentine's Day was St. Valentine's Day, and it was a religious feast day. So even with this Anna Karenina issue and the legends about the amethyst ring and the cutting out of parchments and all of that and sending hearts. How does Valentine's Day, this religious feast day, how does it become connected to notions of romantic love, erotic love, and just the general notion of love between people, individuals, men and women? Well, that has an interesting backstory also. And it connects to the venerable bead. It connects to the grave on the Via Flaminia, which was cared for by Benedictine monks. In 1300 AD, almost 1,000 years later, Queen Emma, the queen, the Norman Queen of England, because she was an avid collector of relics, and in the late Middle Ages, in the high Middle Ages, I should say, collecting saints' relics was a major devotional activity. And a relic, for those who may not be familiar with this custom or tradition, is a fragment of bone, because of course tissue, soft tissue, doesn't survive, a fragment of bone or clothing or some artifact that was associated with the saint in question. Well, Queen Emma, an avid collector of relics, allegedly, upon the burial of her son, King Hardin Canute, in 1042, donated the alleged head of Valentine of Tierney. And she donated it to the Abbey, the Benedictine Abbey in Winchester. And remember, it was Benedictine monks who cared for the tombs of St. Valentine on the Via Flaminia. The Venerable Bede was a Benedictine monk. And that brings us to 1300, when on the Abbey calendar, Valentine of Tierney was always accorded a double feast day. Now, what has that got to do with anything? Well, what's important is the Abbey at Winchester was near the Tabard Inn. And it is from the Tabard Inn that Chaucer's Pilgrims and the Canterbury Tales depart. And Chaucer frequented the Tabard Inn, and he would have heard the stories from the monks about St. Valentine's Day. And keep in mind, this is 1,000 years later, from 396 AD, we're now in 1342. 1,000 years later, he connects that then to romantic love in his poem, The Parliament of Fowls. And The Parliament of Fowls was a poem written by Chaucer to celebrate the engagement of Richard II to Anne of Bohemia. And the notion is that every year, every spring, and it gets complicated here with calendar dates. You might say, well, February 14th wasn't the beginning of spring, but actually in Mediterranean climates it was. And we don't have time today. It gets really complicated because we have to talk about lunar calendars, the Julian calendar, the Gregorian calendar. So without getting into all of that, February was when early February, middle of February, was when people began to think of the return of spring. Well, according to legend, the birds migrated back north, and Chaucer creates a poem to celebrate it. They would then meet in a parliament where the birds would choose their mate, and they would pair off, they would couple. For this was on St. Valentine's Day, when every bird cometh there to choose his mate. You know well how St. Valentine's Day, by my stature and through my governance, you come for to choose and choose your mates. St. Valentine, that artful high on loft, the singing small fowls for thy sake, now welcome summer. So 1,000 years later, Chaucer connects Valentine's Day with romantic love and choosing a mate. Interestingly enough, he gave only one bird, one woman, one female bird could refuse, and that was the formal. F-O-R-M-E-L, a formal is a female eagle. The formal could pick her own mate, but all others were picked by the men. And that is the beginning of the connection in both Western culture, but specifically in English culture, of the connection between Valentine's, St. Valentine's Day, and romantic love, which of course then touches directly with, and Chaucer was playing right into this, the late medieval notion of courtly love. Courtly love was a concept of romantic love between a man and a woman largely created by the Provençal poets of the High Middle Ages. And it was an attempt to legitimize romantic attraction between men and women, because amongst the aristocracy, what we would call royals, marriages were not romantic. Marriages were not based on emotion or love. Marriages were economic and political decisions. And so a woman or a man could find themselves married to someone with whom they have no interest, who they don't care for. And where are they going to find their emotional release? Well, humans being humans are going to find that emotional release somewhere and with someone else. And so courtly love is a poetic tradition that comes out of Provence in the south of France that it basically legitimizes adultery. And it legitimizes romantic, erotic love outside of marriage. And it actually has a formal code.
Ooh, who wrote the book of love?
Well, actually, there's an answer to who wrote the Book of Love. The Book of Love, at least in the Western tradition, the Western European tradition, which becomes then, of course, the North American tradition through its roots in European culture. The Book of Love was written by Chevrien de Troyes and Andreas Capellanus. De Troyes wrote Lancelot, the Knight of the Cart. Capellanus wrote The Art of Courtly Love. Both of these were written in the late 12th century. And of course, love, this kind of love, erotic, heterosexual love, was only for the aristocratic. Knights declared themselves a vassal to the lady. The ideal was a lady of higher status. The aspirations of the lover only for those who were noble. Marriage was no real excuse for not loving. It was a way to express love outside of marriage, to remove the stigma of adultery. It referred both to the emotion of loving and to sexual love. A true lover considers nothing good except what he thinks will please his beloved. Nothing forbids one woman being loved by two men or one man by two women. And so that whole tradition of courtly love then gets combined with, through Chaucer, with Valentine's Day. And Valentine's Day becomes the great expression of courtly love. And the first real definite example of that was Charles VI in France, created the Court of Love, which was celebrated at his court every year on February 14th, Valentine's Day. And then by the time you get into the late Middle Ages and the High Renaissance, there is a great tradition that Valentine's Day is the day for lovers. There's a great tradition in English and European poetry of that, but also in other customs that we'll discover. For example, Ben Jonson's To Celia, drink to me only with thine eyes and I will pledge with mine, or leave a kiss but in the cup and I'll not look for wine. Later in the High Renaissance, what were known as the Cavalier poets wrote a lot of Valentine verse. Some of the most famous would be Robert Herrick's to his Valentine on St. Valentine's Day, which, by the way, if you read it carefully, is both romantic and erotic. And he plays a pun on the word couple. Oft I've heard both youths and virgins say, birds choose their mates, back to Chaucer, and couple too this day, but by their flight I never can divine when I shall couple with my Valentine. And so you have this tradition already developing of the combination of romantic and erotic love that is celebrated on Valentine's Day. And that gave rise to an entire tradition of Valentine poetry. Another Charles, not the same one as I mentioned earlier, Charles de Orleans, wrote one of the first Valentine poems. He was imprisoned in the Tower of London after having lost a battle to the English. I'm not going to embarrass myself by brutalizing the pronunciation of his medieval French, but the rough translation of that medieval French is, I am already sick of love, my very gentle Valentine. You also begin to see it domesticated in the Paston letters, which were the letters of Marjorie Bruce to her husband, John Paston, in which she talks about her husband as my right well-beloved Valentine. So Valentine, and just after Chaucer, becomes associated with romantic love, not so much a feast day.
Roses are red, my love. Ooh.
Now that was Bobby Vinton, I think it was a 60s or 70s or 50, I don't know when, a long time ago, American pop singer's version of Violets Are Blue, Roses Are Red. You ever wonder where that came from? Well, it comes from actually Edmund Spenser's The Fairy Queen. She bathed with roses red and violets blue and all the flowers, sweetest flowers that in the forest grew. It also came from a children's poem book, a book that was used to teach children to read and write, Gammer Gurton's Garland, in which it said, the rose is red and violets blue, the honey sweet and so are you. Thou art my love and I am thine. I drew thee to my Valentine. The lot was cast and then I drew and fortune said it should be you. The lot by there is interesting. People chose their Valentine by lot, by lottery. That is also an ancient custom. It's as recent as whatever happened in the most recent preschool where children, in order to avoid the children competing with one another, they pick who they're going to send Valentine's to by picking a name out of a hat. Interestingly enough, that has deep and ancient roots, and we're going to look at those in a second. So anyways, by the time you then get to the High Renaissance, Valentine's Day is no longer a religious feast day. It is a day of lovers. So much so that Ben Jonson, in his poem play, A Tale of the Tub, bemoans it and writes, let us example to deeds of charity, to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the weak and sick, to entertain the poor and give the dead a Christian funeral. These were the works of piety he did practice and bade us imitate, not look for lovers or handsome images to please our senses. So by this time, you actually have people lamenting that this religious holiday has turned into a holiday of lovers with romantic and erotic overtones. Well, Ben was fighting a losing battle because there were major traditions in European culture at the time, both low and high. Amongst the common folk, according to an 18th century observer, Henry Byrne, one of the things that happened on Valentine's Day was it is a ceremony never omitted amongst the vulgar to draw lots, which they term Valentines, on the eve before Valentine's Day. The names of a select number of one sex or by equal number of the other put into some vessel. And after that, everyone draws a name, which for the present is called their Valentine. And then what ensued was a night of drinking, revelry, in general hijinks. And it was kind of an earlier version that the drawing of the Valentine by lots accomplished three things. One, everybody got a Valentine. Two, there was no jealous politicking or jousting to see whose Valentine was who. And three, it was kind of an ancient version of what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. But this was a well-established tradition throughout Central and Northern Europe. At the other end of the social scale, amongst the aristocratic elite, Valentine's Day was the ultimate lover's day, the day of seduction, the day of romance. But it was also something else. It became the major gift-giving day. This was particularly true in English culture, but I think it was also true throughout European culture, at least amongst the aristocracy, that the major gift-giving day wasn't Christmas. In English culture, the major gift-giving day used to be Twelfth Night, and to a lesser extent, New Year's Day. But by the time you get to the High Renaissance, the major gift-giving day, what Lee Eric Schmidt calls ceremonies of consumption, the major gift-giving day was Valentine's Day. That was the day in which you gave gifts. This is a turkey stone. The English 17th century English diarist Samuel Pepys congratulated himself on giving his wife a large brooch, a turkey stone, which is a kind of in an oval shape, a ruby surrounded by diamonds. So that was the major thing. So we have, by the time we get to the 17th and 18th century, Valentine's Day is a long way from what Pope Gelasius thought he was creating 1400 years earlier. Its roots as a religious feast day, it has begun to be forgotten. And in fact, the very meaning of the word Valentine has changed It no longer means a religious feast day. It means the object of one's desire, and to a certain extent, the gift one would give the object of one's desire. And that begins to change yet again in the late 18th, early 19th century. In the late 18th, early 19th century, you have, and we don't have time to get into the economic history, you have the rise of the middle class. Remember in that previous slide, I showed you what the common folk did and what the aristocrats did. But by the 18th century, you have the rise of the middle class. And a middle class, one of the things a middle class does is it civilizes or tames the social extremes and domesticates it, if you will. And that happened, and I'm using English culture as a background here, that happened with the rise of the notion of sentimentalism, which, without getting too philosophical, was also actually a reaction against rationalism and the Enlightenment, and rationalism that you knew everything through your mind, not through your feelings. This was a kind of pushback against that. Actually, it's a precursor of the rise of Romanticism, which is the major philosophical pushback against rationalism, but that's for another topic. The impact here is the rise of sentimentalism, expressive of or appealing to sentiment, especially the tender emotions, love, pity, and nostalgia. And in the English world, English-speaking world, you see that in the beginning of the earliest novel, sometimes called the first novel or English novel, was Samuel Richardson's Pamela, in which a serving girl resists the seduction, the seductive ploys of her patron, who then, to be impressed by her virtue, marries her. Oh, and the most famous example in English literature of this is Laurence Sterne's A Sentimental Journey, in which he describes his journey through France and Italy. Travel literature prior to that would have used a lot of classical allusions, and it would have been a very philosophical discussion about all the great landmarks. In Sterne's, he's not interested in all of that. He's exploring his own emotional reaction and how he felt about it. Well, the complete triumph of sentimentalism in the 18th and early 19th century, of course, and again in the English-speaking world, are the novels of Jane Austen. And sentimentalism, or sensibility, prioritized feeling. It's how you felt about something was more important. And of course, this ties into Romanticism, because Austen's novels, which seethe with a kind of suppressed sexuality, are all about how you find a marriage partner. And actually, in Austen's world, to be fair to Jane Austen, this was a deadly serious enterprise, finding the correct marriage partner, because in a world in which a woman's only real opportunity at economic advancement was who she married, and a woman's only economic opportunity was marriage, if you failed to get married, if you were a spinster, you better hope that your brother was a decent person, or you became a kind of social pariah. Well, we don't have, again, a lot of time to go into the depth of that, because we're just talking about Valentine's Day. But Austen was Austen's novels are very serious, actually. And her greatest novel along those lines is, of course, Sense and Sensibility, in which the elder sister, Eleanor, is a rationalist who has to learn to trust her emotions. And the younger sister, Marianne, is a very emotional sensibility, a very emotional person who has to learn to take a little bit more prudence. Well, all of that then begins to tame Valentine's Day. And Valentine's Day then becomes the great expression of a domestic middle-class love. It's been tamed from the kind of raucous, think spring break partying of, as Henry Byrne called, the vulgar or the common, or the more elegant but still raucous partying of the aristocratic culture and gift giving. It has been turned into a domestic expression of love. And it's, which is interesting about that is, courtly love legitimatized love outside of marriage. It legitimatized adultery. Austen is legitimatizing love inside of marriage, that you can actually find marriage, love inside of marriage, and that's the domestication of it. Well, Valentine's Day then stays this kind of middle-class holiday until a revolution occurs in 1840. And the revolution that occurred in 1840... Well, the revolution that occurred in 1840 in Great Britain was Sir Rowland Hill's Postal Reform Act of 1840, in which he had the idea that if you made it cheap and easy to send letters, you would increase the volume of mail, and thereby increasing the volume of mail, you would increase the revenue into the national treasury. And he invented the postage stamp, and that is it right there, the penny black, the very first postage stamp. He set off on the rule of unintended consequences. He created a social revolution that's actually in some ways larger than Valentine's Day, but it transformed Valentine's Day yet again. In 1835, there were 60,000 Valentine's cards. Now, even now the word is changing its meaning yet again. There were 60,000 Valentine's cards or letters sent in 1835. 1 year after the postal reform, that number had increased by a factor of 7 to 400,000, and by 1871, 1.2 million. What Sir Rowland Hill created was the greeting card industry without knowing that he had done that, initially through the Valentine's cards. And immediately London printers such as Jonathan King created a Valentine card industry. It was a handcraft industry dominated by women who made these cards. They were all handcrafted. Charles Dickens called it Cupid's Manufactory. And now Valentine's have become cards. So we go from a religious feast to Valentine is the object of your love, to now the Valentine is a card. And it has become a middle-class holiday. And these are some examples of 19th century British Valentine's cards, which have become quite ornate, and with the sentiment, this one here, if you can read it, I'm lost in admiration as I gaze upon thy graceful form. And so Valentine's Day has become a card-giving thing, particularly in Great Britain. Well, that jumps to America in 1840 when there is a general mania for Valentine's at Yale University and other colleges across the Northeast, in which people are, young men, college was male in those days, sending Valentine's sometimes to one another, but frequently to their girlfriends at home or in town. And again, we see, as I said a minute ago, a change in the meaning of the word Valentine, so that now Valentine is a card that is sent to you to express someone's admiration for you or affection. And that then leads to the beginning of Valentine's cards as an industry in America. And that was created by a woman named Esther Howland. Esther Howland is the mother of the American Valentine. She is also the creator of the American greeting card industry, if you will. Esther Howland is a really interesting figure. She was one of the first American women to graduate from college. She graduated from Mount Holyoke Seminary in 1847. And her father owned a stationery company in Worcester, Massachusetts. Her mother actually wrote the New England Frugal Cookbook. But Esther received a Valentine's card from an admirer. And when she looked at this cheap Valentine's card, she said, I can do better than this. She thought, this is nothing. I can do better than this. And so she implored her father to buy her some supplies, which he did. And she created a Valentine industry, first on the third floor of the family home, that's it down here in the right-hand corner, later in a factory space she bought in Worcester, in which she would design the card, and then she hired women. And she was actually a proto-feminist, because the only people she ever hired were women. Women to make the cards, women to ship the cards, women to pack them, etc. She created jobs for women so that they could earn an income to help support their families. And what Holland would do is she would create the card, and then that card would be faithfully reproduced by the women. And Esther Holland actually created the American Valentine's card. And you can say Esther Holland created the American greeting card industry. And she deserves to be more famous than she is. These are Howland Valentines. They are works of art. The largest collection is at the Hallmark Museum in Kansas City and at the Museum of Art, the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. And if you happen to have one of those, you could probably pay for your child's college education today. But once upon a time, they were throwaways. So Esther Howe, so by now, at the time we get into the 19th century in the in America, Valentine's Day is a day to exchange cards. And they were cards. And there were all kinds of them. Some of them, like the ones up at the top, were simply postcards, you know, to my Valentine with Cupid whispering in his ear, do it now, and then they kiss. There was also something called vinegar Valentines, which were satiric Valentines, such as the henpecked, the wife with a corkscrew tongue, the shrewish wife, the lemon Valentine, in which this young woman gives this gentleman to my Valentine a lemon. 'Tis a lemon that I hand you and bid you now skidoo, because I love another, I have no time for you. Henpecked husband. This is another one where a Valentine. And there were also, by 21st century standards, very tame, suggestive or racy Valentines, such as this one here of the cute little girl, parking permitted evenings by appointment. The way to kiss, and then this one, and actually Angela and I's images are covering it. You can't read it, but this is somebody out, you'll notice the woman has her arm around the man as they're out driving in an early, late 19th century automobile, and actually the slogan up here is, you can go as far as you want with me. And so there were all kinds of Valentines. The other thing that occurred in America in the middle of the 19th century was a consumer revolution, because Valentine's Day became a gift-giving day. Christmas, as Americans celebrated, as we learned in the episode on Christmas that we did last December, is essentially a creation of the late 19th and early 20th century. Valentine's Day was the major gift-giving day in America in the 19th century. And the fact that we're gonna spend $20 billion on Valentine's today is still an echo of that gift-giving phenomena associated with Valentine's Day. And one of the things it did, Valentine's Day created the American consumer culture, whether it was at T.W. Strong in Publishers and Engravers in New York City or Fisher's in Boston. Valentine's Day created the notion of shopping. And it was the combination of Valentine's cards, stores beginning to realize they could sell gifts and notions. Stores in these days were called notion stores. They sold small personal grooming items, cards, and small items. That turned into major department stores through the marriage of advertising and the new, at that time in the 19th century, mass circulation newspapers and persuasive advertising changed American stores from these old-fashioned male-dominated, notice in this picture, every person in that image is a male, these male-dominated and somewhat dark stores to these large shopping emporiums. And one of the things it did was it changed who shopped. It became women, and shopping became something women did. And that was a major transformation that Valentine's Day had in the 19th century. And 19th century gifts range from elegant scarves to jewelry. You know, a woman would give a man a watch, of course, flowers. This over here where the cursor is at the moment is called a puzzle purse. And it was a card that folded down upon itself that you could put a small gift in. And if you want to know how to make a puzzle purse, you can go to marthastewart.com and find the instructions on how to make one of those yourself. One of the other things that happened in the 19th century, Kevin Cuneo in his column in the Erie Times this morning mentioned it in passing, is I have said a couple of times that we sell 36 million.
Under my skin, I've got you deep in the heart.
We sell 36 million boxes of heart-shaped boxes of chocolate. I think it's something like 57 million pounds of chocolate will be sold on Valentine's Day. Where did this come from? Well, the notion of chocolate as an aphrodisiac and associated with romantic and erotic love is ancient. In relatively speaking, modern European history, it's most commonly associated with Madame du Barry. Madame du Barry was the mistress and lover of Louis XV. She was Marie Antoinette's nemesis. All three of them ended up as victims of the guillotine. But Madame du Barry, according to legend, began every morning with cocoa, because cocoa, chocolate, was thought to have an aphrodisiacal stimulating effect. And according to legend, Madame du Barry gave her lovers chocolate mixed with amber, allegedly to increase their ardor and their stamina. Now, where did the heart-shaped boxes of chocolate come from? That's from John Cadbury, who founded Cadbury Chocolates in Birmingham, England, and his son Richard Cadbury in 1868 sold, and this is it right here, the first box of heart-shaped chocolates. And it's from that that chocolates shaped, sold in heart-shaped boxes come down to the present. In American pop culture, probably one of the earliest and most famous examples that would have connected chocolate, Madame du Barry, and Richard Cadbury all together is the scene in the 1934 film Dinner at Eight of the great blonde siren of that era, Jean Harlow, sitting in an elegant bed. Notice the pillow behind her is heart-shaped, eating chocolates rather salaciously, if you see the film, as she is teasing her just off-screen, outside the camera, lover. And of course, you know, candy kisses are given. And did you ever wonder why a Hershey's kiss is called a kiss? It's because the sound of the machine as it dropped it sounds like a smooch. And they just decided to name them Hershey's kisses. And then the complete domestication of Valentine's Day was accomplished by Joyce Hall, J.C. Hall. J.C. Hall was the son of an itinerant Methodist minister who abandoned his family. At the age of 9, he became a door-to-door salesman. Eventually, he settled in Kansas City, Missouri with his brothers. They opened up a stationery store where they sold cards and greetings. The store burnt down. They figured out they were making more money selling cards than they were anything else. They bought an engraving company, and they began to make their own cards. And it was Hall who first invented the card that folded over and that you put into an envelope. But J.C. Hall, who says he was hell-bent on quality, was also one of the apostles of that it was the sentiment that counted. And he invented the notion of the trademark. He noticed that medieval jewelers would mark their creations with a mark. And so they began, I think in 1928, to put on the back of every card the hallmark to say that's who they were. And then in 1944, he created or coined one of the most famous slogans in American advertising: when you care enough to send the very best. And Hall always said it's the sentiment that counts. So he created Hallmark.
Gonna take a sentimental journey. Gonna set my heart.
And so that is pretty much how we get to today. So we get from Pope Gelasius attempting to suppress the revival of a Roman fertility ritual, through Chaucer, through courtly love, through the Middle Ages. We get to today, where Valentine now means a card and a gift. We spend $20 billion on flowers, chocolates, and gifts. And that is how Valentine's Day evolved in both Western European and North American. As I said, this is part of a larger project, the American Tapestry. You can find it at WQLN. Go to the Jefferson website, you can find other versions of this. And actually, my two book notes last week, and there's another part two coming out this week, are in fact a much more detailed narration of, in fact, the history of Valentine's. So that's Valentine's Day. That's how you got to sending or receiving a Valentine today. That's why you'll be taking someone out to dinner tonight and probably having a bit of chocolate somewhere along the way. I'm going to stop the share and get back to Angela. So that's Valentine's Day, a very short, highly condensed history.
Thank you, Dr. Roth. This is a fabulous parkour through the centuries, through the millenniums, actually. I thoroughly enjoy that because I actually came to America and I wasn't too familiar with Valentine's Day. So there's still, demand to learn. There's still countries to adopt the Valentine's Day. I just read that in China, it is becoming very, very popular. You can get exactly like the typical Valentine's fair. You write cards, you buy chocolate flowers, and you go out on a date. So they have adopted the model. I don't think they can call it Valentine's Day quite yet. So, but just a way to see how adaptive this holiday has been since its origins and going through the motions of societal change, just very fascinating. So I just have one concluding question for you.
Sure.
What do you see will prevail from the rather romantic, maybe old-fashioned way of celebrating Valentine's Day? And then today, everything is more on social media, and in the last 2 years, it has been a challenge for a lot of people to meet in person and find new romance.
Well, I think Valentine's Day is one of those holidays. I mean, humans are going to do what humans do, which is humans are going to get together. And Valentine's Day has become, like you said, over the millennium, we're now in the third millennium, the universal celebration of lovers. I think I mentioned earlier, it is not an official holiday anywhere. By official holiday, I mean a holiday where the government would close down and businesses close. It's not an official holiday anywhere, but it is celebrated. Some version of it is celebrated in more countries in the world than any other holiday. It is almost a universally celebrated holiday. As you mentioned, with Chinese would probably have no idea where this holiday came from. And I suspect most Americans have no idea that it began as an attempt to suppress the revival of an ancient fertility ritual. And it is possibly a little bit of a stretch to connect it to that, but that is the fact, the days overlap. I think it will last forever. And actually, in some ways, now that it has been drained, for the most part, drained of its religious origins and has become, like, I don't want to use the word secular exactly, but like almost the universal secular holiday of romantic love and domestic love, of that it won't go away. It survived 2,000 years. I don't see it going away.
I'm with you on that. And I think it is a beautiful celebration, especially in times of, disconcert and, disputes everywhere we go. So it has the potential to actually bring a little bit of joy and peace in the world. So
I think it does. Yes, it does.
Yeah, because we need more love in this world.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, so we've reached the end of the conversation and your presentation was just fabulous. I encourage everyone to, if you missed it, if you want to rewatch it, to go to YouTube or our webpage, and even on Facebook, you can rewatch it again. Please stay in touch with us, stay in touch with Dr. Roth. If you have any follow-up questions, we'd be happy to answer. Thank you to all of you watching along at home. Thank you for tuning in. I hope you will have a good rest of the day. Valentine's Day, take some time out of your busy day and remember the origins of Valentine's Day, the meaning of it. We'll be back with future programs with Dr. Roth. I'm looking forward to all of that. And be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you so much for the Jefferson Educational Society. I'm Angela Beaumont. May our holidays be as merry and bright, as informative as they can be. And thank you again, Dr. Roth. Thank you for listening and learning.
You're welcome, Angela.
Thank you.
Take care.
Have a good day. Have a good Valentine's Day.